How's the motion here? It's not bad. If the Olympics can take place all day long, why can't I broadcast all day long? It's more relevant, isn't it? Practically speaking, have to maintain the yard, which is continuously falling apart, right? No end to it. The weeds are growing everywhere. There's leaves everywhere. Horrible leaves. Flower petals look great on the bush, right? But then they drop, covering the driveway, choking the gutter, on and on and on. So that's the problem. Continuous maintenance of this world is a big problem. And everybody wants somebody else to do that maintenance for them. Of course, they say, oh, look out, look at the... If you look at a bush, we have a beautiful one out here. It's just gorgeous, just covered with blossoms. If you look at that, and you don't have to maintain anything, you don't have to cut it, don't have to trim it, don't have to clean up the continual drops that it gives all year. Flowers and leaves. Then you say, wow, what a beautiful bush. I love this bush. Isn't it marvelous, darling? And if you have to do all the maintenance work, it's not so beautiful, believe me. When I look at that bush, I'm only thinking, doggone it. Look at all those blossoms, thousands of them, and stain in the driveway. I have to clean it up. It's a horrible amount of work, this doggone bush. Like, you know, what a pain. That's what I'm feeling. And occasionally I look at it and say, you're beautiful, but then I think, oh, wait a minute, all the high maintenance beauty, you know, high maintenance beauty, not so great. So don't be fooled by those who gush about how beautiful the world is, because they're not doing the maintenance work, guaranteed. Nobody who has to do all the maintenance work is meaning, you know, gushing about, have this light feeling like, oh, it's so beautiful, look at the shrubs. Yeah, so beautiful shrubs. Yeah, well, somebody's having to trim those shrubs every week to make them look so beautiful. And, oh, the stonework is so beautiful. You know, somebody had to quarry the stone. Somebody had to distribute the stone. Somebody had to set the stone, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, again, don't be fooled by those who say how beautiful the world is. I guarantee you this, let them spend 30 years maintaining all of this so-called beauty on a permanent basis and then ask them how they feel about the world. I'll tell you what would be good for the elites and those who have a need of a deeper understanding of the world is let them do the maintenance work, let them clean the streets, see how they feel. Maybe they'll have a change of heart about this world. Eventually they'll get there. Eventually they'll get there. Sooner or later, no matter how high you go in existence, you find yourself on the bottom. And you find out, hey, you know, maintaining all this facade of existence is hell. So much work. Dirty work. And then you'll start thinking, wait a minute. I don't want to just go back on top again, because I know I'm going to find myself down at the bottom again. What fun is this? What fun is no fun? How can you enjoy your stay at the top if you know you're going to go back on the bottom again? How can you possibly? Because all you're thinking about is, how can I possibly withstand being down on the bottom again? This is horrible. I don't think I can take it. So how can you enjoy being on the top? The only way you can enjoy it, you think you're always going to stay there. And you don't. You do not. Maybe in one particular lifetime you can, but subsequent lifetimes you won't. So, the idea of just enjoying this world is nonsense. You need to spend your time here focusing on remembering reality, which is permanence. No maintenance in reality. There's no maintenance. There's no matter. There's no energy. There's none of that. It's essence. Essence never decays, never gets sick, never gets old. There's a complete, like, plasticity to reality that is, you know, beyond what we can imagine. But having fun here, really? That's our purpose? Okay, well, I'll tell you what, those who want to have fun can come over and maintain my yard. How about that? That won't be so fun, believe me. And when they're done that, they can repave the road here. You know, we can wash the windows. You know, we can find lots of things for them to do if they want to have fun here. So I'm pretty critical of those who say just have fun here, just have fun, because inevitably there are those are the ones saying that are not doing any of the maintenance work. Everything is falling apart here. You just have to have eyes to see it. When you get an entitlement complex, you don't even see it. Like, oh, I don't even see it because it's not my problem. Why should I see it? If you're honest and have integrity, you'll say, wait a minute. What a nice, you know, plant, but look at all those dead leaves. It's horrible. Can do. I gotta trim it. The pot is cracking. You know, and there's weeds growing in the pot, the soil's getting old, I gotta repot it, and oh my gosh, and everywhere you look, ceaseless change, ceaseless maintenance. But those who say, hey, just enjoy the world, have fun, how much maintenance work are they doing? Just ask yourself that question, how much maintenance work are they doing? Probably none. You know, if you get the sanitation all worked out, etc., there's still constant problems. Sanitation, pipes clogging up. Oh, man. I tell you, I went out and tried to help the world, tried to help people who had problems, and what did I find? Incredible problems. People with homes that are just absolutely packed with stuff, like hoarders, you know. Everything falling apart. You could work there the rest of your life and still not be able to deal with it. And there's places like that. I felt sorry for the people. You know, they're being choked by stuff and by decay, and they can't keep up. And I said, maybe I'll help them. And then I ended up working myself, you know, to exhaustion, just trying to help out. It's terrible. And when you get finished with that, you realize there's more and more and more. Never ending. Never ending. That's no fun. I mean, like I said, let those who are preaching just have fun. Let them then do the maintenance work, if, you know, so we can have fun. And we'll see how much fun they're having. They have. And everything needs to be reset. I mean, all the pavers, everything, you know, over time gets out of whack. You got to redo it. Ground is always shifting. I mean, in the United States right now, the infrastructure is just getting beat up. In the Midwest and a lot of states, because of the extreme conditions, extreme rain, extreme drought, extreme heat, extreme everything, and the infrastructure is crumbling. It's crumbling. Scary thing. Really scary thing. The storms, roads buckling, railroad tracks kinking up. It's a massive problem and could get severely worse. So, who's going to fix all those roads? You know, take an airplane flight, you know, how many facets of workers went into producing that airplane flight? All the maintenance people at the airport, all the maintenance people of the machine, the airplane itself has to be maintained by an army of maintenance workers. All the baggage people have to load all the baggage, all the food, the fuel, someone has to, you know, put an oil well down there, get the oil, refine the oil, transport the oil. You know, transport the fuel, store the fuel the plane up. The tires have to come from somewhere. All the equipment, the plane has to be built. Equipment, it's a massive enterprise of people building and maintaining just so, you know, we can take a plane flight to Tiruvannamalai or wherever, like Costa Rica. You know, let's hop on a plane, go to Hawaii, let's go to a retreat there, etc. And so we're having fun, we're having a luau on the beach now. Meanwhile, the resort we're staying at is an army of maintenance workers, the maids, every day coming in, they take all the sheets. The sheets, you know, have to go down to the laundry service. Someone has to laundry all those. Someone has to fold all those. The whole resort is crumbling. I mean, you go to old resorts that used to be beautiful and they're crumbling. You know, they can't keep them up. Cannot keep them up. Everything. Everything for those who are just having fun, the boats they ride on, the planes they ride on, the cars they ride in, the roads they ride on, the utilities that they make their life comfortable, everything needs a massive amount of maintenance. And if you don't do it, gets up your problems like, you know, utility in the Bay Area had their big gas explosion a while back. And they now have to do massive upgrades. Just an incredible task. In our town, they're having to replace all the water mains through the whole doggone town. Digging up every single road, replacing it with a new type of more flexible, more durable plastic. I guess for durability, longevity, and earthquake protection. They had to replace all the water main water from reservoirs, etc., into town because of earthquake problems. Had to tear out the old one, replace it new. It's unbelievably tough work. All that stuff, just so we can, you know, turn on our tap and get some water and have fun. I guarantee you, those guys and a few gals that are doing all that maintenance work. Well, actually, the gals do a lot of maintenance work when it comes to certain stuff. Men are doing the heavy work, heavy machinery work, etc. But the maids, all that stuff is usually done by the gals do that. And so all of those guys and gals doing all the maintenance work in the world, they're not having fun. They're not having fun. Maybe they go home and turn on the television and watch, some kind of dancing with the glitterati. Think, wow, I'm having fun watching these people having fun, but their lives are not fun. Don't worry about having fun in this world. Don't worry about it. Take on the challenge of remembering reality. And whether it's fun or it's not fun, you know, it intrinsically is fun because you're freeing yourself from delusion. That's fun. But whether you appear to others to be having fun is irrelevant. Don't even pay any attention to that, because, you know, to others you may look like you're a stick in the mud. You're not having any fun. I mean, people look at my life, they must think I'm not having the slightest bit of fun in the world. Never take vacations, never go anywhere, never do anything. Can't afford to. Sitting here taping, what fun is that? It's a lot of fun, actually. Clarifying, seeing freedom, light at the end of the tunnel, that's fun. Going down that tunnel, you see the light at the end of the tunnel, that is fun. Don't have to make others think you're having fun. How does anyone know? Feeling of integrity, that's fun. Better than fun. But it is no fun. This afternoon, I got to do a lot of maintenance. And I know it's not going to be any fun. I got to take a sawzall and cut some bushes, very, very large branches. It's going to be a real pain. I know that. Not fun at all. I'm not going to have any fun. Sweating, getting, I'm sure I'll get all tired after it and achy. How about dieting? Is that fun? Not really. I mean, and most of us have to diet. How much fun are we having? Can't even eat the food we want to eat. How much fun is that? It's either easy for people with a high metabolism who can eat anything to think, hey, I love eating food, but most of us, I put on weight just looking at food. So I basically have to starve myself to lose any weight, and to maintain a decent weight, I have to like hardly eat anything. How much fun is that? It's not fun at all. I'd rather be eating chocolate ice cream every night. So it's hell. It's terrible. Not having fun. Not having fun seeing, older people going to retirement homes, assisted living, and falling apart, getting sickness after sickness, and sliding into the abyss. That's fun. Not having any fun at all. That way, worry about having fun. There's no fun police here monitoring. Are you having fun yet? Who cares? And most people are just experiencing the brutality of existence. I mean, the truckers have to move everything in the U.S. Everything we have is moved by the Teamsters, the truckers, and some, you know, Teamsters, independent, all these truckers. They're out on the road. Is that fun? I wouldn't characterize it as fun. Driving the big rigs. No, that's work. That's not fun. And we wouldn't have anything if it weren't for them doing their work. The longshoremen, unloading all the ships. I mean, every day you just do the exact same thing. Unload the containers, move the containers, put the containers on trucks. The trucks truck them, you know, out to distribution centers. Distribution centers parse them out to stores and ship stuff. Maybe some ship direct, you know, UPS, FedEx, etc. All these delivery people having to deliver these packages, etc. You know, it's work. It's work. I don't know, you know, how much fun it all is. Besides that, we have to maintain everything. It's always falling apart. All those trucks have to be maintained. The ships have to be maintained. The cranes, the heavy machinery has to be maintained. Parts constantly, stuff's breaking down. I mean, I work with people who use heavy machinery and heavy work and concrete work. You know, it's brutal work, brutal. And do they have fun? Well, they try to smile. They try to smile, laugh, joke, but come on. They know if they stop working, they're gonna, you know, starve. How much fun is that? I mean, it's not exactly that much fun realizing that you're just one accident away or one illness away from, you know, having your house foreclosed on, being thrown out in the street, being unable to work, not having enough money for, you know, to support a family or even eat, etc. I see all these homeless people all the time. There's just armies of homeless people. They move into abandoned homes and try to survive one way or the other, but it's just brutal. They're not having much fun. You see people getting in accidents. They're now in assisted living situations. Vegetables, they're not having much fun. Seeing them is not much fun for me. Seeing, as I go around, seeing the problems of the world, that's not fun. Seeing the problems of impermanence, that's not fun. I don't see too many gurus, cleaning the streets, cleaning the gutters, picking up trash and hauling it to the dump. Doing the lumbering work. I mean, we wouldn't have any houses if it weren't for all the lumberjacks, the guys who cut all the trees down, haul them out of the forest, load them, you know, on trucks, truck them to the lumber mill, cut the lumber, load them on another truck, distribute it to a lumber mill, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Everybody's working hard, blood, sweat, and tears. That's not much fun. It's a lot of adrenaline, maybe, but don't worry about having fun. That just adds to the guilt. Thinking, how come I am not having fun digging ditches, you know? I feel like I'm dead in the morning and, what's wrong with me? I'm not having fun. Forget about having fun. It's not important. Work on remembering. Remembrance of reality. Remembrance of reality. What is the way to remembrance of reality? Work on that. And if you can make that fun, fine. It is work. But just like, you know, it's like any other work. Hard labor. It's hard work. People don't like it. I work with laborers, hard labor, all different types. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, they're not laughing or joking too much. You know, it's ridiculous. Did you have fun today? And you say, you're kidding? I was up on a roof all day, and up on the roof, it was like 120 degrees. My feet are like blistered. I'm dehydrated. I'm exhausted. I'm filthy. I'm beat up. I'm tired. You know, but I got to do it because I got to pay bills. I don't know, paying bills isn't so much fun, you know. Don't worry about having fun. Don't think that everybody's having fun and you're not. I'm not having any fun, really, except working on the path of remembrance. How to remember? Path of remembrance, it has its own fun, own satisfaction. I wouldn't say it's fun. There's satisfaction and integrity and hope that you're going to finally be free of this madhouse. But laughing and having fun, you know, that's for kids. And some who are able to maintain that through privilege and status and all of that kind of stuff. Who can afford to pay everybody else to pay all their bills and have plenty of extra and get everybody else to tough work. But there's not many of those, really. And we keep trying to have artificial fun, but don't waste your time chasing after fun. It's a waste of time. Who cares if you're not having fun? We feel guilty in our society that we're not having fun, because the whole society has been promising us fun. We've been promised fun, you know. We're all having fun. See the USA in a Chevrolet. Come on, let's go. Let's have fun. Let's travel. Gosh, traveling could be misery. Need a vacation to recover from your vacation. Go to a restaurant, you get sick, food's terrible, and you get all sorts of problems, and you can't sleep. Yeah, but we're having fun, we're seeing places we've never seen before, but we're miserable. Again, we have this severe guilt complex in the world that we're not having fun, that we're supposed to have fun. Why? Because the ego tells us this world is our home, and we're supposed to learn how to have fun here. So we feel guilty for not having fun. Like, wow, I'm not being a responsible person because I'm not having fun. That's all nonsense. This isn't our home. This is a contingency. It's an attempt to. It's a denial of reality. A belief that reality can be changed. That reality is impermanent, and therefore this is a contingency. We're going to have to make this our new home. It's all a lie. It's all nonsense. We don't have to learn to love this world. We don't have to learn how to have fun here. We don't have to learn how to be happy with the situation. When we see permanence, we have vision of permanence, then we are blissful. That's different. That's different than fun. That we don't even require, you know, we don't pursue fun anymore. We don't need it. We realize it's bogus. It's just painting a smile on a sad face. Putting on a happy mask over a, you know, crying, suffering face. Face of existence is misery, and we keep trying to put a mask on it. So we have this culture of having fun, you know, forget about it. I remember the people running onto my ma. None of them looked like they were having any fun. I said, they're so serious. Yeah, because they were engaging themselves in the challenge. You know, every guru, all the people who go see teachers, everybody's smiling. They got this like, we're having so much fun. This is so much fun. You didn't see that in the past. Yeah, these people are real like, you know. They weren't like, hi, I'm having fun. this is really neat. Now they're like, wow, you know, this is really difficult. This is really a challenge. This is really consuming all my effort. So, yeah. No, don't need to pretend that you're having fun. It's not necessary. No one who is trying to remember truth is going to judge you based on how much fun you're having or not having. It's understandable that it's tough work. It's hard work. It's the hardest work there is in the world, really. But it's the most satisfying, and it's necessary. You can't escape it. So don't put the burden on yourself of also going out and having a whole bunch of fun. Because, you know, you'll realize that's a waste of time. Waste of time. Why pretend? You know, you're not happy. Why pretend that you are? You can't be happy in this world. We can't be happy with impermanence. It's impossible. So why even pretend? To please the ego, right? To try to empower the situation. Try to say, yeah, I believe in it. Yeah, I believe in the goals, you know. So be a cheerleader so we can hopefully, you know, make impermanence permanent and adjust to it, etc. But that's futile. That's futile. It's futile. So don't worry about being happy. But don't worry about having fun or being happy or anything like that. It's not relevant. It's a waste of time. Be serious. Be focused. Maintain your focus, your inquiry, your intensity, your stillness, your clarification, your purpose of what is the means of remembrance of reality. What is the means? How can the means become available to me? Right? How can the means become available to me? That's I get up in the morning, that's what I'm thinking. How can the means become available to me? What is it that I'm not doing? How come I don't have the means available to me yet? That kind of thing. That's the question. It should be a question on everyone's lips and mind every day. And that should be the topic of discussion. I mean, it's incredible. Everywhere I've gone in this life, I've never heard that discussion one time. Other than very specialized, isolated situations. But I've never really come across those. I mean, I see satsang someplace taking place, and there is that focus. But other than these extremely isolated, rare situations, you know, go anywhere in the world, and is that the topic of conversation? How can I make the means of remembrance available to myself and to others too? What is the means of remembrance, and how can I avail myself of that? Is that what people are talking about? Is that what they're discussing? Is that what they're focused on? No, they're focused on everything but that. Unbelievable, incredible. It's all a pretense. It's all a show of support for trying to accomplish the impossible, trying to make the impermanent permanent, trying to be happy with impermanence, trying to be permanently happy with impermanence. It's not possible. It's a waste of time. My gosh, everybody just starts the day out with these fun shows and in the evening with all this fun stuff, comedians, yakety yak yak. Aren't we having fun? My God, what a waste of time. Don't have to be laughing. You don't have to laugh. What are you laughing? You know, what's funny? Except seeing the silliness of these defenses, what we use. I laugh when I see these defenses and how silly they are. That's amusing. But otherwise, you know, I'm not laughing along at this world. I'm not laughing here. It's not funny. It's not really funny. Gallows humor, you know, is all it really is here. Everybody's trying to laugh so they don't cry. But if you really know that you can be free of this, you're not gonna waste your time in compensation like that. You're gonna say, forget it, I'm working to get free of this. I'm not gonna waste my time yucking it up. You know, humor is fine. A sense of humor is okay, but yucking it up, No. It's comedians, you know, trying to make us laugh. It's pathetic. There's nothing funny about this world. It's terrible. This nightmare is terrible. This insanity, this attempt to destroy reality is terrible. We're paying a fearsome price. It's not funny. We forgot to laugh at the initial idea after that we thought we could be prime creator. That's funny. We should have laughed then, but we didn't laugh then, so now we're crying now. So, again, the theme of this video is don't need to be laugh. You can be serious. Don't need to be seeming to have fun. There's no reason to feel guilty about any of that. You don't. It's not a sign you're on the spiritual path if you're laughing and having fun. That's no sign. Don't worry about your self-image. Those who know truth are not looking at your self-image. They're just looking at your effort, right effort. And those who don't know truth are looking at your self-image. Or what does their opinion count anyway? Doesn't count at all. Counts for nothing. Those who believe that nothing is something, you know, why place any value on those opinions? Just lay low, be serious, be intense, be focused, right effort, get the work done, get it done, get it done, get it done. Continue to get it done. It's the one work here in this world that is truly necessary, truly valuable, and that truly pays off. And it pays off with something totally beyond fun or happiness, with bliss, with eternal delight. Let's not pretend that that this world gives us eternal delight. That's nonsense. Gives us endless suffering is what it gives us. Now, the great saviors that come here, they're in eternal delight because they're not seeing the world. They're seeing reality. They're seeing permanence. They're seeing through this world, as it were. This world, the structure rises, but it doesn't interfere with their awareness of permanence at all. The dance of impermanence has no effect on their perfect awareness of permanence. Anandamayi said, even though the existence continues, you know, the dance of change, of existence, all around me in the halls of eternity continues, as what I am remains exactly the same. So it didn't cause the slightest unawareness of truth, of reality, of permanence. Dance of impermanence doesn't affect permanence at all. So you can be in the world but not of it. You can be aware of permanence and still be in this world. But the bliss, the eternal delight is not coming from this world. It's coming from your vision of reality. And people are trying so hard to have fun in this world. I mean, that in itself is amusing. How hard everyone is trying. My gosh. They're just desperately trying to have fun. Like it's a religion. It is. The religion of the world is really to have fun. Be happy, laugh, and have fun here. That's the real religion of the world, is put on a happy face, make the ego proud of you. Be proud that you're trying to adjust to impermanence. That's the world. Be proud you're trying to adjust to impermanence, and give it your best shot, and let's all help each other out. Let's have fun here. And so someone like myself, I was dead serious from the very beginning. All my pictures, young, very, very dead serious. There are no smiles there. There's no thing. I was no laughing matter. Coming to this world is no laughing matter. You know, people try to lower themselves down to be animals, you know, like puppies and dogs running around. Hey, so much fun here. So much fun. Can't escape it that way. Can't escape it that way. Because the defenses that we need to use to keep trying to fool ourselves cause extreme misery and problems. We don't If we're not aware of him now, we'll be aware of him later, that is for sure. We try to escape this, all our complexes, the mental defenses, by just trying to be like physical, like animals, getting into our bodies, so to speak. That's useless, waste of time, terrible, tangential misdirection. You've got to face the problems of the mind, and you've got to see where they're coming from, and you have to remember, avail yourself of the means to remember reality, the permanence of reality, and drop this insane attempt to replace reality. You have to take it on. You have to take on the challenge, and that's serious business. And it's not so fun. I mean, it's a challenge, which is satisfying, but it's tough work. It's not so much fun. A lot of times you'll be very brooding, very serious, very brooding. Like, you know, you just like you're really troubled. Like you're looking at this trouble, and you say, "Wow, that's really some bad battle over there." And I don't know. We'll get free of that trouble. It's a serious business. All the while you're getting older, you have to keep paying bills. The demands of the world are insatiable. So of course you be serious. As you go along, you get a little more lighthearted, naturally, because you get more confident. You can get free. But it's not a forced, fake lightheartedness. You know, like you're not putting on an image. It's just spontaneously is there. But that shouldn't be the goal. The goal is to do the work, and then the effects will eventually come along with it. Don't try to put the effects first, thinking that then that the goal will be reached if you're just happy and act like you're blissful, that somehow that's going to free you. That's putting the cart before the horse. Jesus said, first seek the kingdom of heaven, and everything else will then be added unto you. Okay, that's the right way. Don't try to put on a facade that I'm so happy, I'm so having so much fun, I'm so blissful. That must mean, therefore, that I've done the work. That's a charade. Don't do that. You know, a lot of us have done that. Pull out of that. That's the temptation. If I just act all happy, I must be happy. That the conditions that bring unhappiness can't be there. Even though we haven't chosen to repent, we haven't chosen a new idea, we haven't given up the idea of wanting to be prime creator. As long as we have that idea, we're going to be miserable. The unhappiness will be there. So keep making the effort. Don't have to be smiling all the time. You know, if you can, that's fine. Because people don't like a frowning face when you go out in public. You've got to like pretend to be happy. You might be really depressed. I mean, most of the time people are severely depressed here in this world, really. And when you get on this spiritual path, it's somewhat depressing, realizing, oh my gosh, look at, you know, I feel so, it seems so difficult, and the world is so terrible. Everybody's so trapped. It's a depressing thing. You go out in public and you need to pretend to be happy. So certainly if you go to a grocery store, wherever you have to do, you know, smile, how are you doing? Be nice. Pretend to be happy a little bit, but, you know, don't take it seriously. That's not a facade you need to keep up all the time. Get back into contemplation. Get back into inquiry, get back into satsang. You can be serious. Not a fake seriousness, natural. Again, just because you pretend to be serious doesn't automatically mean that the seriousness is really there. The topic matter is intrinsically serious, consequential. The difference between life and death, between freedom and slavery, the difference between nightmares and endless delight. And so, serious consequences. Ramifications. So quite honestly, it's a serious thing in that way. But again, you don't, like, the same thing with, like, happiness, pretend to be happy. be thinking that the cause of unhappiness must be gone. Same thing about pretending to be real serious and somber, but as if that automatically means that you must be engaging with the challenge. No, it doesn't automatically mean that. Effects don't automatically mean you can fake effects. But in engaging with the challenge, you will, you know, feel this sobriety come over you. Like, hey, you know, this is not a joke. When you're engaged in something that is really challenging, you know, you're very sober. It's not a joke. You're not yucking it up. It's like you're driving this big semi-truck through some windy mountain roads, you know, and you're heavily loaded down. And, you got to be on it. You know, you can't be yucking it up. You gotta be focused. It's just a natural focus that comes in when you engage in these questions. You know, you're on point, like a retriever. You know, they go on point. Look at them; they're all focus. You know, dogs can like really focus. Tremendous focus. Everything is focused. You know, they're focused. Because they know that there's a challenge right there. They're ready for the challenge. They're engaged in it. You have to have that focus. Engage. Engagement. Engagement. You know, it's engagement with the inquiry. You got to engage with it. And that's a, you know, it's a serious, consequential thing, because the benefits are so extreme. You know, and they're right there. And you realize there's a way to get those benefits, and if I don't get them, I don't get them. If I continue on with delusion, then I'm going to suffer. So it's very consequential in that way. All right. Is this one under an hour? Yes, it is. Maybe I'll keep it under an hour. I know I'm punishing everyone with these long videos. But again, it's kind of like running a marathon. It's like getting you ready for running a marathon. It's very helpful. You have to, you know, those who get in shape reap the benefits. Spiritual shape. Those who do it will reap the benefits. For instance, what if one that was perfectly assured us, had a permanent reassurance of permanence, came into the world? Wouldn't we want to listen to them, like, you know, nonstop? Engage with that long period of time? Yeah, we would. But if we have no capability to do that, how could we do it? You know, it's like someone who's completely out of shape running a marathon. How could they do it? They're going to break down. Fall asleep. So the effort to engage and be on point, And understand that you don't have to put on airs of being happy or having fun doing it. It's not necessary. Practice that. You're really putting yourself in a great position. Great position. You know, you might be able to, you know, spend days and days and days at the feet of a perfectly realized being. And what kind of benefit would that be to you? It would be extraordinary. Extraordinary. So by all means, get in great spiritual shape right now. That's what I'm doing. You know, I'm not worried about my physical conditioning, which is like zero right now. And, you know, forget it. Forget it. Because it's spiritual conditioning we need right now. Because the opportunities that are coming are spiritual opportunities. You cannot outrun the problems of the world physically. You can transcend them spiritually. Okay? So it's not a physical thing that is coming up in the world that we need to be in some great physical shape. We need to be in great spiritual shape. Top-notch spiritual shape. Spiritual Olympians we need to be right now. So let's be spiritual Olympians. All this training, you don't think those Olympians go through massive training? Of course they do. Massive. Can we not go through massive spiritual training also? So we're in super great, so we're spiritual Olympians? Yes, we can. We're doing it right here. I'm a spiritual Olympian. There you go, flying the flag over the spiritual Olympics. In great shape. Ready for big boosts and great options and opportunities. Ready to sidestep troubles. Ready to move on down the road away from troubles. All of that. So let's be spiritual Olympians. All right, very great. I may even make another video today too. But for this time, let's end this one right here. Be a spiritual Olympian. Keep training. All right, very great. That's it.